They should not be the people seeking power. They should not be men and women who power up on other people and say, you just do what I tell you to do. That is not the heart or the attitude of Christ. And so one way you can tell whether someone is genuinely spirit-filled is how willing they are to submit to others and to serve them. Now, what he's going to do is Paul's going to say, as a result of this general attitude of submission that we are to submit to everyone, this is how it works in your houses. This is how it works in your places of employment. And so these are known as the household codes. And it's not just here, but literally we see the household codes in Ephesians, in Colossians, and in 1 Peter. So Paul and Peter talk a lot about it. We could have titled this sermon, Peter, Paul, and Marriage. Hey, I had to. And if you don't know why that's funny, then yeah, look up good music. Okay, so... But here's the idea, is these house codes were not just a Christian invention. In fact, in Greco-Roman times, the house codes were set standards, even from the time of Aristotle. And they were ways that said this is how households are to conduct themselves. Because in the Greco-Roman world, the household was viewed as the foundation of the state. That they viewed proper management of the household as vital to the society. It was a vital political concern. So I love it because what God says is like, hey, here's how things really work. God's heart is for the family, for marriages, because it is the most important singular unit within a culture, within the church. It is the bare bones basics of where things begin. God has a deep concern for the family unit, and so he begins by talking about the Christian households, but he starts with submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And then he talks about what this submission, mutual submission, looks like for husbands and wives, for parents and children, and for slaves and masters, which in our context would be better understood as bosses and managers. So most of you have been married or will be married or are married. Most of you either were kids, well, all of you were kids. So you had parents or maybe will have your own children. And then all of us have worked at some time. So this is something that it will at least touch on one, if not multiple areas of your life. Now, what we're going to see is that Christian wives, children, and employees are to show submission by following the servant leadership of husbands, parents, and masters. And that Christian husbands, parents, and employers are to show submission by the way they sacrificially love and care for wives, children, and employees. Now, loving submission in each one of these cases is based on our worship of God, that we are directing this attitude of the heart towards God. There are major exceptions to submission, meaning that if someone is being verbally or physically abused, the Bible does not demand submission. In fact, it's the exact opposite. You are to get out of that situation. And any church that encourages you to continue in violent, bad situations is not reading the text properly. Also, when someone commands you to submit to doing something that is contradictory to God's will, that is not something the Bible says, because ultimately our head leader is Christ himself. We follow him above all people. So, again, too often these verses have been used to subjugate and abuse women and children. And I have no interest this morning in doing that. That is sinful, it is unbiblical, and it is nonsense. So you're not going to hear any of that this morning. But what we want to see is that God has a good plan for mutual submission in the family. So let's talk about marriage. Are you ready? That was a huge runway. Are we okay? I'm nervous. Are you nervous? All right, let's get into it. Marriage. Now, let's just do some major important provisos here. I know you're like, Eric, just get to the text. Oh, we'll get there. But listen to the first one. This is so important. Marriage, and this is so important, is not designed to make us happy. Amen. Oh, thank you for the amen. So good. You can both amen that. You can both amen that. Why? Now, why do I say that? Because we have this delusion that someday my prince or princess will come, right? This idea that when I get married, it's all going to get better. And how many people that you know when you get married, it does get better in some ways, and it gets harder in other ways. Because God does not design marriage to make us happy. He gave us Jesus for that. That I find my satisfaction and fulfillment in Christ. I cannot try to put that weight on my spouse. It will crush your spouse. If you need them to satisfy your soul, only Jesus can do that. So God gave us marriage not to make us happy, but to make us holy. Now there is joy in that, but there is also hard work. Now this is a contrast to the modern idea of the marriage partner that will fulfill us. That idea is dangerous and disappointing. We will always be disappointed when we expect a human being to fill the place in our heart that only God can fill. Now, one of the reasons that talking about marriage is so hard to talk about is there is a tremendous amount of hurt and disappointment surrounding marriage. There is abuse, there are divorces, there are loveless marriages. Some men and women have been absent or abusive or emotionally distant or overbearing or manipulative. They have withheld love and affection for the sake of control. And ultimately, many men are experiencing that they have not been well loved by their spouse. And so ultimately, we are far from perfect, but God still has a good plan for us. God has put in place a design from the very beginning, and this starts in Genesis. Just very quickly, you're like, Eric, we're going all the way back. Oh, yeah. Why? Because in Genesis 1 and 2, he talks about what? Marriage, family, and work. So if you see in Genesis 1:27, he says, so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them male and female. He created them. Both men and women are the crown of God's creation, created in the image of God with total equality of value. God created both of them for a good purpose, and then he gave them work to do. Look at verse 28. God blessed them and said, be fruitful and increase in number. That's the family component. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the sky and every living thing that moves on the ground. Do work. And so you see good marriage, you see good family, and you see good work. Now, how does that work? Verse 22. Wives, submit to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. Now, this is how we know this is a transition verse, because literally in the Greek, it says, wives, as to your own husbands. It is connected to verse 21 because what Paul is saying is like, this is what submission looks like. Let me give you an example. Wives, submit to your husband. Again, this is to arrange under. This is a voluntary decision by the wife because of her love of Christ to submit to her husband. Husbands, this is not something that you are to demand of your wife. If you ever tell your wife to submit, there's probably larger issues in your marriage. Wives are to submit to their own husbands, not to every man, but to their own husbands as to the Lord. Not in the same way they submit to God, but again, out of reverence and respect for God as an act of worship. So moving to verse 23. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now, four here links the idea. Why do you submit? Because the husband is the head of the wife. This is what is said in 1 Corinthians 11:3 as well. But I want you to realize the head of every man is Christ, and the head of every woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. And in this authority structure, head denotes a responsibility for. The focus is not on privilege or dominance of the husband, but it is at the husband's loving role in caring leadership. The job of the husband is not to boss his wife around. It is to be her servant. That is the goal of healthy marriage. Paul redefines leadership as the person responsible to live, to give, and to nurture the one that is they are responsible for. Now, Ephesians 24 says this. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Now, Paul continues and he moves on to husbands in verse 25. Husbands, Love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Now this is how, I love this, right? Because we just had some really hard passages about submission. Now this is how the husband submits to the wife. That he views her as more important than himself. That he loves her in the same way that Jesus has given himself for the church. The sacrifice that he makes. There is an unselfish love that is shown in this relationship, that a husband does not rule over his wife, but instead he puts himself under by sacrificing for her needs. And the husband's relationship with God is the basis for his sacrifice. Look at what Christ did for the church and how husbands are directed to do for their wives in verse 26. To make her holy. Again, this is the husband's role, but this is Christ's role. Paul is linking the analogy here. Cleansing her by the washing with the word, which is regeneration by being born again. Through the word, which is the preaching of the gospel. And to present her to himself as radiant in splendor, a radiant church. Without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, without sin or spiritual decay, but holy and blameless, set apart without blemish. This is the purpose of Christ's sacrifice for the church, that he would make this beautiful sacrifice to bring his people, his church, into relationship with himself, to love her well. And this is the purpose of a husband's sacrificial servant leadership, is to love his wife in the same way. He gives himself freely for her benefit. Look at verse 28. In this same way, husbands ought, and that's a strong word, baby, that means should. Husbands should, they ought to love their wives. How? As their own bodies. We'll get into that in a second. It's a really good analogy. He who loves his wife loves himself because of the unity of husband and wife. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body just as Christ does the church, for we are all members of the same body. In the same way, in the way that Christ loved and sacrificed his life for the church, that is the model, and the husbands are to do the same for their wives. They are to feed and care for their wives. This is the idea of a tender nurturing of the husband for the wife. Feed means to nurture or build up. Care means to cherish, to cultivate with care and affection. He who loves his wife loves himself. Because no matter how much you don't like your body, you're still probably going to feed yourself. Even if your body is undesirable from time to time, you're still going to take care of it. Okay, so he's making this analogy. Feed and love your wives. Now, I love this because this is such a contradiction to the way we understand leadership. Really, what he's saying here is that the head of the home is really the heart of the home. That in this case, the leader is the lover, and authority is always rooted in affection. This is, and so you're like, Eric, what does that look like? Well, let me give you a quote. And I thought this quote summed it up. If you're like, husbands, what are we supposed to be doing? This is really what Paul is saying. Whatever will bring her joy and be to her benefit, I will submit to do happily. Because all I want is her joy and her spiritual benefit. I submit to her joy, to her fulfillment, to what blesses her and encourage her, and exercise my leadership in that way. You ladies can just start applauding whenever you want. Like, I thought that was really good. I saw that and I'm like, oh yeah, that is it. Do you love that? I love that. Because we have such a misunderstanding of what leadership truly looks like, and it has been so thoroughly abused that this looks foreign. Yet this is what we are called to as husbands. Look at verse 31. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united with his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. Now, this is one of the best, my favorite verses in the Bible, because this comes again from Genesis 2, but it also is again in Matthew 19 where Jesus repeats it. So you get Old Testament, Gospels, and now you get epistles. Why? Because God wants us to understand two things. One is how amazingly intimate and interconnected marriage is supposed to be. This is the idea of leave and cleave. Maybe you've heard that. The idea is that when you get married, you make a covenant with your husband or wife. You leave your family of origin and you start your own family unit, just the two of us. We can make it if we try, just the two of us. You and I. Come on, Bill Withers. If you don't know Bill Withers, come on now. Now here's the idea. It's not just leaving, but it's cleaving. It's literally God takes two souls and he glues them together, but it's even more than glue. It is welding. It is making two metals into one. It is a bond that is never meant to be broken. Now, here's the crazier part. God uses marriage as a way for us to understand his love and intimacy with us. Just a little bit. Come on, just a little bit. He's like, hey, your most intimate human relationship, I want you to know that that's the way that I want you and I to be. But this is why this is so huge, because it is rooted in the way that God loves us. We mess this up so easily because we are such broken and flawed people at times that we just don't love this way. But Paul says it's a mystery. It's a mystery because it's difficult to understand fully. I can't even wrap my brain around this fully. God wants me to love my wife in the way that he has loved me. Wow, that's huge. We are to love each other this way. And then Ephesians 5:33 finishes it off and says, however, each of you must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. And to the end that both Christian husband and wife were working towards this end, marriages will be rough during seasons. But ultimately, if they are moving towards Christ, there will be a beautiful thing that God is doing between two people. A married couple is a team. Both are looking to serve one another. Both are speaking truth and love. There's got to be a ton of communication. Because as a wife, if I'm looking to submit to my husband's caring, sacrificial leadership, I need to know what he's doing. If I'm a husband and I need to sacrifice myself for my wife, I need to know what she needs. There has to be a ton of communication. And even beyond that, there needs to be a ton of forgiveness. Why? Because you could ask my wife, I am not Jesus. Okay, that's not a shocker, by the way. You're like, wait a second. I am not Jesus. And guess what? Neither is she. And so we will love imperfectly. And so our relationship must be marked by the forgiveness of Jesus. Okay, now the easy stuff. Family. It's like a roller coaster ride. Come on. All right, let's talk about family, because the house codes, they deal with marriage, but then they deal with children. Verse 1 of chapter 6. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on earth. Now, this may look pretty clear, but let's pull it apart just to understand a little bit more here. Children does not denote an age. It denotes a relationship. You will always be someone's child. And so this verse to obey is very interesting. Now, first of all, the word obey is different than submission. Okay, so obey and submit are two different things. So the relationship between a husband and wife are different than the relationship between a parent and a child. A child is to obey as what it says here in the Lord. Again, it's their act of worship to obey their parents. For it is right. This is what is appropriate as God has designed it. And then Paul uses this reference back to the fifth commandment in Exodus 5. And this is exactly where he quotes it. And he says, this is how you should live. You should live in a way that honors and respects your parents. Now, the difficult thing is that when you're a parent to a child, it's usually a straight one-for-one relationship. But what about when you grow up? right? I love my parents. I'm 44. Does it mean I still need to obey them? Yes! Oh, it's so good. And my parents are going to be here next service, and they're going to be like, come on, get after it, boy. Get after it. Why? Now, this is very important. Obedience looks different, right? As a grown man, obedience looks different. I still honor and respect my parents. Now, I don't always do exactly what they tell me to do, but I listen to them. As a child, unless they're asking you to do something that is not godly, we are to obey our parents. Now, there's an obligation there. What's the flip side of it? Look at what Paul says in verse 4. Fathers, and this word can also be understood as parents. So fathers or both parents, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. And so what does this mean? Exasperate means don't make your children unnecessarily angry, because God knows you will make them necessarily angry. That is part of being a parent, is you have to do things that your kids will not like for their best interest. But to exasperate your children is usually when your ego gets involved. It's usually when you're disciplining your kids and they're being kids. Right? I know with me, there's no one that can get under my skin like my kids. I love them, but they have no fear of me, which is both good and bad. Because when I was like, you better do that, and they're like, or what? I'm like, man, or what? Come on now, like, go do that thing I ask you to do. Because, you know, that's normally not the way we act in society. If you ask someone to do something, they bow up on you, like, no, I don't think I will. But your kids can do that. And in that moment, parents have to check their ego and the way that they relate to their children. Because if we power up on our kids, we will make them angry unnecessarily, and we will miss the point, which is to bring them up in the training and the instruction of the Lord. Now see, we can fall off on either side of the horse when it comes to parenting. There is permissive parenting, where you just want to be your kid's friend. And on the other side, there is strict parenting, where there's no grace, it's just compliance. What we know from that kind of strict parenting is that rules without relationship equal rebellion. When you're just trying to break your kid instead of trying to train their soul. And so many times, especially with strict parenting, you can see the kid that is sitting down on the outside but standing up on the inside. Do you know what that looks like? They're following because of fear, but not following because of love. And this is the difficulty within parents, is we're not trying to crush souls, but to train spirits. Now there's an overarching goal here, and Paul is basically repeating Deuteronomy 6 and 7. I love this. These commands that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children, which means teach them diligently the word of God and how to walk in God's ways. Talk about them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. And so the idea of training parents and love, or training children, is that that our children will be immersed. They'll be immersed in a culture of God's works, his words, and his ways. And so that God in every way marks our parenting. Does that make sense? Okay, you with me? Okay, shake your head a little bit. Good. Okay. So, work, and I got to keep rolling. But this is like three sermons in one, right? Again, another trilogy for you. So, work. Paul says that in case you didn't get enough with marriage and family, which I know is a bunch, he gets into the idea of how we do our work for the Lord. Now, again, he's going to use the term slaves and masters, but in a modern context, this would be better understood as bosses and managers, and there's a responsibility to both. Look at verse 5. Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey God. And we see that common theme is that working for my boss as an employee is something I do as unto the Lord. Respect and fear is not to be afraid, but it's a matter of honor. And so when he gets into verse 6, he says, obey them not only to win the favor, to win their favor when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ, do the will of God from your heart. I love this, because this idea of only when their eye's on you, literally the word is eye service. Now, let's just be honest. Have you ever had a job where you kind of slacked off and the boss would come around and you start cleaning real hard? It's the same. This morning, God gave me an example because I wasn't speeding much this morning, but when I was driving into church, a police car passed me. And do you know that? You immediately, like, man, I am right between those lines and I'm riding 40 on the nose. Now, what Paul's saying is don't do that. Don't just work hard when the boss is looking at you. But you want to work in such a way that your work is your witness, as if you are serving God. And that's what verse 7 says. Serve wholeheartedly, as if you were serving the Lord, not people, because you know that God will reward each one for whatever good they do, whether they are slave or free. And so our work is our witness. The desire is not just to get a larger paycheck, but to be rewarded from God for being faithful. I had a friend of mine that worked for the city of Loveland, and I would see him, I'd say, hey buddy, how you doing? He's like, oh, you know me, I'm working for the Lord and getting paid by the city. And I love that attitude, because he said, basically my job is to serve God, but right now I'm serving God by working for the city. And so our attitude is the same as employees. Now, as we've seen with parents, as we've seen with husbands and wives, he turns the tables and says there is a responsibility for masters or employees, bosses as well. Look at verse 9. And masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Okay, bosses. It means treat them with respect and honor. Treat them with respect and honor. Again, there's mutual submission, but it looks differently. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no favoritism with him. So the treatment of your employees should reflect the treatment that you have received from God himself. Don't abuse your power, but treat the people working for you well, because you and they are under the lordship of Christ. Does that make sense? Okay, so here's the deal. And I know this is really sticky wickets. And I know it's really challenging, because none of us come from perfect marriages, perfect families, or perfect jobs. What God is giving us is an opportunity to step into difficult relationships with the love and the light of Jesus Christ and be a witness by the way that we serve and love other people. And so as you've heard these words, I guarantee you should feel a little challenged, and if not, you just weren't listening. But here's what I want to say, and this is so good. Because of God's grace and love, you are fully accepted by Jesus. The more you step into the love and the grace that God has given you through Christ, the more you will be able to lovingly serve your spouse, your kids, and the people you're working with. And if we ultimately want to be a witness for Christ, we need to do all three of those things for his glory and for our good. Okay? I'm so excited we got that done. And next week it's spiritual warfare. So, you know. All right, let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your word. And where it is challenging, we ask that you would give us discernment. Where we are lacking in wisdom, we ask you, Father, to fill in the gaps. And Father, I pray that you would burn away anything that I have spoken that is not accurate to your word, and only your word, which stands forever, would remain. God, help us. This activates big feelings in us, because many of us have had really, really bad experiences. And so, Father, I pray into those experiences, would you continue to heal us? God, would you continue to show us more of your grace? Help us to forgive those who have let us down. Help us to forgive those who have taken advantage over their position of power and abused it. Help us, Father, ultimately to trust in your love and to seek you for all that we need. We pray this for your glory and our good, in Christ's name. Amen.